This is in part why President Biden issued an executive order back in January, intended to right the historical wrongs Black folks have faced when it comes to housing and home ownership in this country. But first, let's take it back.
The dawn of the 20th century, African Americans in major cities lived scattered throughout the city. They weren't segregated particularly. It's only with the great migration of 6 to 7 million African Americans north and west escaping the south, the predominant response of the United States government and state and local governments to the great migration was to contain Black people in their own neighborhoods.
Some African American communities are prospering, like the residents of Greenwood in Tulsa, Oklahoma. A remarkable Baptist pastor named Solomon Sir Jones is the pioneering filmmaker. His footage was lost for more than 50 years. Jones captures the bustling life of Greenwood, which could be any American small town. But Tulsa's whites don't like what they see. In May 1921, after a Black man is accused of assaulting a white woman, a white mob rampages through the city. For a night and a day, they loot and burn Greenwood. A Fox News crew captures the only surviving footage. It is the bloodiest racial massacre in American history, leaving nearly 300 dead.
Among the most well-known was a Black district in Tulsa, Oklahoma, known by its residents as Greenwood.
If we were to go back in time to 1920 and walk up and down Greenwood Avenue, one thing that would probably strike us is the absolute variety of businesses. The numbers are astonishing. 30 restaurants, 45 groceries and meat markets. There were dry goods stores, milliners, a photography studio, dental offices. Greenwood is no longer called Greenwood. It's now known as Black Wall Street.
This whole idea of self-containment really existed there. The dollar would stay in that community sometimes over 3-5 years before it ever went outside of the community.
1919, Black soldiers returned from World War I with high expectations for racial progress at home. But in one city after another, white mobs erupted in violence, targeting Black veterans, citizens, and businesses. Hundreds died. On Tulsa's Black Wall Street, African Americans, including armed veterans, watched nervously and prepared for what might come.
Countering this white militancy is very much an African American spirit of, we're gonna defend ourselves. If the mob comes, we're not gonna run, we've got our guns and we're gonna protect ourselves. And that was especially important and valuable and potent in Greenwood.
On May 30th, 1921, the mob came to Greenwood.
Blacks in Tulsa are armed. They take their Second Amendment rights seriously and they come with guns. And this is a threat. Someone fires into the crowd and the riot is born. This was about Blacks becoming too economically powerful and showing that wealth in a way that anyone would by creating buildings and constructing churches and having property.
100 years ago, a beautiful empire built on Black excellence was booming. Black Wall Street, it was a sight to be seen. Until one day, it was all burned to the ground. But fire is no match for the fire within Black dreamers everywhere. And so, new Black Wall Streets rise. City is committed to helping build Black businesses through banking.
I want to give all the praises and the honor to Yahweh Bahashem, Yahweh Shah Bahashem, Recha HaKodesh, and double honors to the elder apostles and even the elder bishops of Great Millstone. Honors as well to you, brethren. Sincere honors to you, brethren. Salute to you, and even shalom to you, few sisters. Also, shalom to the elect. So anyway, before I get started, first, take a look at this picture right here with the Jake on the right and his, I believe, his woman or wife on the left, whoever she may be. One thing I noticed about this Jake, when I looked at his face, the senior elder Jake, he looks like he's comfortable. He looks like he's in his power, right? And clearly we wasn't having women and children out of control in that kind of environment. More than likely, that was not going to happen. And I just wanted to point that out because you can see how this Jake, he's sitting here. He's confident. He's in his power. You see his head up. You know, you don't see Jake look like that today. And this is why the Most High always gave us a glimpse of what it can be like to be in our power. But he's not ready for us to be in that power until the upcoming next transfer of rulership. Right now, okay, now the video I want to go into, I'm not going to make it long by the Lord's will. This is raw. I did want to go into this Citibank commercial because that did intrigue me to go further into that, because this Citibank commercial says Black Wall Street rise again. And I'm like, how the hell are they rising again if it's under the structure or the thumb of another conglomerate bank, right? But doing some research, I even saw Judge Joe Brown, anybody know him, in an interview. He was also going into the fact that these people at Greenwood, because Greenwood was a city in that area that was 45 blocks or so. They had everything. I mean, they was flourishing. But they were renting those properties, you know. They never really owned, technically, Black Wall Street. They did own the businesses, but they never owned the actual property. So it was only going to be a matter of time if they didn't bomb it in that setup with the white woman in the elevator with the black boy, young black man whistling at her. They did the same thing in Rosewood, the same thing with Emmett Till. We know how it go. But if that wasn't the case, if they didn't bomb it, they would have found some tax laws or some loopholes to break those Jakes and take all they had and made them combine with it. You know, there was a guy named LeVan Hawkins, I remember, here, and he's from Florida, and he owned a string of Checkers restaurants. And I knew, and I was young back then, but I still knew it was a matter of time before he sold out, because all of our people was going and buying Checkers. They really wanted to support a black business. But as long as you give so-called black people, Israelites, a glimmer of hope, they'll flock to that and try to support it. But this man is not going to allow it. Why? Because Yahweh Bashim Yahweh is not going to allow it. Now, this truth is the same thing, right? This is why we're sitting up there now like this man with the cigar in his mouth, right? We're not prideful, but we're proud to be in the truth. We can now hold our heads up and say, you know what? We're in the truth. This is our heritage. This world is for our sake. All we're going to do now is wait until the Lord to return and put us back in our rightful rulership. But also, I want to go into this video because I want to go into Deuteronomy 28 to further prove. Now, this Deuteronomy 28, the various different parts of the Bible, has prophecies, and some go back and some goes forward and some even still applies today. Right. So if you go to Deuteronomy 28 and 15, it says, but it shall come to pass, if thou will not hearken unto the voice of the Lord thy God, to observe and do all these commandments, all the commandments and his statutes, which I command thee this day, that all these curses shall come upon thee and overtake thee. Verse 16, curse shall be in the city, and curse shall thou be in the field. All right. So now we got to know what a curse is, which everybody should know what a curse is, or at least have an idea of what a curse is. You know, you'll see in those movies they cast curses on people to make their life miserable. So the word curse means a prayer or invocation for harm or injury to come upon one. You know, to profane or obscene oath or word. Okay? Something that is accursed, an evil or misfortune that comes as if in response to it, imprecation or an retribution. So let's go with imprecation. See what that means.
Imprecatory.
But it's actually imprecation. Okay, here we go.
Imprecation.
The act of imprecating. A curse. So you get the point. So let's go back to Deuteronomy 28. Cursed shall be thou in the city, and cursed shall thou be in the field. You saw as they took a flight, you know, the so-called black people, we took a flight and, you know, fled from the south to come to the north to live a better life, so to speak. We was catching hell in the north, too. There's no escape from the curse, man. You know, catching hell in the north. And then you had traitors, just like you see on the basketball, football, these sports teams. They were traitors. They were trading back and forth then. And we don't want to get into Harriet Tubman. That fraudulent behavior, which her husband was probably the real hero. But anyway, let's go on further. It says, cursed shalt thou be in thy basket and thy store. Okay? It also says, cursed shall be the fruit of thy body, and cursed shall be the fruit of thy land, the increase of thy kind, and of their flocks. Now, I want to go into cursed shall thou be in the city and in the field. I actually went to the commentary. A lot of commentators didn't want to touch on this. There's only one that really did. And that's the Matthew Henry commentary. It says, I want to get to the point. Many judgments are here stated which would be the fruits of the curse and which God would punish the people of the Jews, right? And this is what I want to get to. You can even go into slavery on the slave ships, how we were brought here, and a massacre continued because there was more massacres than Tulsa, Oklahoma, Rosewood, and various other places. This is what I want to get into. How is it that all these things can come upon a group of people in this kind of record numbers, right? Even applying to today with our women over the man, and the man's put down low and feminized. Terrence Howard just said he's leaving Hollywood because Hollywood is, or Hollyweird, or the Holly Branch, whatever you want to call them. They are effeminate. They're writing scripts to effeminize men. You know, which Hollywood goes back to witchcraft. I did videos on that. So what other people on a high level that you could say, look in the history books, what they try to hide a lot and throw it out and lose the footages. You're going to tell me the curse of the Lord after all the history of the Bible that you've read, all the things that happened to the Jews, the biblical Israelites, on and off, you know, punished for years, generations. And in 2022, people who believe in the Bible will not look at this and say, wait a minute, it's got to be these people. 1921 is only 100 years ago. A day of the Lord is 1,000 years. Anyway, it says, for their apostasy and disobedience, we may observe the fulfilling of these threatenings in their present state. Now, clearly, that's why nobody wanted to touch on this, I kind of see. But we know the people who claim to be the chosen are not going through what we're going through, nor do we own anything, you know, on these high levels. Seems that it would have to be talking to a people who would fit these curses. We'll get further proof. It says, to complete their misery, it is threatened that by these troubles, they should be bereaved of all comfort and hope and left in utter despair. right? Those who walk by sight and not by faith are in danger of losing reasoning itself, which everything about them looks frightful. Now, this is crazy. Everything about them looks frightful. Now, when you go back to Deuteronomy 28, it talks about thou shalt be an astonishment, which is a frightening. Anyway, the Lord shall send upon thee curses and vexations, rebuke, and all thou setting thine hand unto for to do, right? Until thou be destroyed, and until thou perish quickly, because of the wickedness of thy doings, whereby thou hast forsaken me. It says, the Lord shall make the pestilence cleave unto thee, until he have consumed thee from off the land, whither thou goest to possess it. Now you've seen the Israelites, we've scattered, we moved. I remember talking to some jakes, they were always talking about going back down south because there's better opportunities. Meanwhile, people fled from the south to come up north and north to go to south. So if you fled to go from the south, from the north, go back down south, I'll ask them 6 months later, well, why the hell did you come back? Right? Because if you know these curses, you would know wherever you go, there would be a curse there. Now, if there's a job that better suits you somewhere else and you could do okay, all right. We're talking about a nation. There is some Jake who did okay, right? But what nobody's telling you with this Tulsa, Oklahoma, and Greenwood, they still had to trade import-export with the white man. He still had pretty much some dominating control over the situation. That money had to consume and run through somewhere, right? It had to run through somewhere. It ain't like they just had it all to themselves, which kind of they did, but they were still working with an out of power. But then you had the lowlifes, you know, white people who just didn't want to accept that. This goes back just like in with Pilate, just like going back to Jerusalem. We had our people who were allowed, I believe in Alexander or maybe some others, who really allowed the Israelites to practice their traditions and do whatever they want to do. All they had to do was pay a form of tax. You know, they had provinces set up, certain things set up, right? But it was always wicked Jake selling us out, you know, causing more turmoil. Ain't nothing new under the sun. Nothing's new under the sun. You can read this whole thing, but this goes, like I said, this goes back and forth between times. We can go to verse 48. Therefore, this is one of my favorite ones. Therefore, thou shalt serve thine enemies, which the Lord shall send against thee in hunger and thirst, and in nakedness, and want of all things. And he shall put a yoke of iron upon thy neck, until he have destroyed thee. So yes, he'll put a yoke of iron upon thy neck, till he have destroyed thee. So a lot of us thought we could break free from that yoke. And you saw Jake standing there with his guns. They was ready to go. But you know what? The Lord let us know real quick. See, we have the power to, we have it in us to raise up and be over Edom and run everything. But the Lord is just not allowing us to do it. And this probably explains, this is another video, with this situation with Simeon Toko. Anybody know who he was? I believe he was a spiritual angel. They tried to kill him. He was a black man. They called him Black Jesus. They tried to kill him. And every time they tried to kill him, they found him somewhere else. He arose. They just couldn't kill him. And then before they finally did kill him, after they killed him like 20 times, He said, there's more of us. So that's where the threat comes with us. And that's what this thing is all about. If anybody know what I'm talking about, trying to get you in that 3-4 point jump shot line, you know, take that 3 point shootout on the jump court. You know, if anybody know what that is, ain't know something, man. And that's the fear. Malachi 2:2, if you will not hear and if you will not lay it to heart to give glory unto thy name, shall the Lord of hosts, I will even send a curse upon you, and I will curse your blessings. Yea, I have cursed them already, because ye do not lay it to your heart. So ultimately, the Lord is going to build this up. The Lord is going to deliver us from this hell we in, right? The elect, Daniel, I think 7:18 says, the saints of the Most High shall take the kingdom, right, and possess the kingdom. So that's what we have to look forward to. I just wanted to do this video to show the hypocrisy that we never really owned a Black Wall Street. You know, it's kind of like your house. You might have owned a Black Wall Street so-called business, but not the in a whole, the property. Kind of like your house. You never really own a house. That house sits on property. You have to pay taxes on that property. If you don't pay it, guess what? They'll take that property and your business comes along with it, goes along with it. Right? So, got to wait on the Lord. That's all I have on that. Shalom.